Hello everybody, welcome to this presentation about ecological niche modeling applications related to public health. My name is Luis Escobar. I am assistant professor in the Department of Fish and Wildlife Conservation here at Virginia Tech. And well, this is, to begin, this is a map of the distribution or areas at risk of chikungunya, which is a vector-borne disease. This is an official map by 2012, published by the World Health Organization to identify areas at risk of infections. Here you can note the very limited detail of the handmade map, which even includes the ocean and demonstrates the limited advances in the areas of disease risk mapping in global public health. This other map is a much better version of areas with past and current distribution of the same vector-borne disease. Chikungunya is caused by a virus that needs a mosquito to circulate. And this map includes the Americas. So this gives much more detail. However, you can appreciate that the smallest unit of this map is at the country level. So here we see this message of the map saying that the disease, you could get the disease or you will be at risk of infection in Alaska, in North America. However, we know that the most suitable areas for the vector are in the tropics. So the idea in applications of ecological niche modeling in public health is to use the theory and methods that developed in biogeography to understand now the distribution of other species beyond plants or mammals or fish. Now we want to understand the distribution of parasites. So much of the theory from biogeography, we believe that the father of biogeography is Alexander von Humboldt. And according to a classic definition of biogeography, it's the study of the distribution of species. And here we have another researcher, John Snow, which we believe is the father of a modern Western epidemiology, which is defined as the study of the distribution of diseases. So here you can see that there is a strong agreement between biogeography and epidemiology in that both study organisms. However, epidemiology focuses on those organisms that cause or disease. The application of biogeography to diseases is pretty new. This is a 2008 publication. It's the only one, the earliest I found related to biogeography, the biogeography of infectious diseases, like a very formal description. And this is a map also related to these ideas. This is a 2014 paper by the same author, by Tom Peterson. So you can see here, the message here is that this is a field that is still emerging. Pretty briefly, something that we have been listening in the previous videos is that we are thinking in environmental dimensions to understand distribution of species. So this map shows the axis of precipitation in the X, and the annual mean temperature in the y-axis. And in the middle, all the environmental conditions, the climatic conditions in the world. And here you can see the distribution in environmental space of the different biomes. So let's focus in this species. Let's imagine that I want to model this single species. So I can quantify the conditions in which these species occur. However, when modeling diseases, we may want to model two species at the same time, the parasite and the host. So the same theory that we apply to model plants or mammals is the same theory that we use to model the ecological niche of parasites. So here, for example, instead of competition with another species, we may include the immune response of the host that is trying to compete against the invasion of the parasite. The early applications of these ideas include a study on the Marburg hemorrhagic fever in Africa. This is a virus causing phone in wildlife that can spill over people. So at the very early years of the discovery of this disease, were very poor in data. So this exploration included the areas where the cases occurred or the regions where the disease was reported. We can see here the disease cases or areas with disease reports are the squares, and the small dot points are the climates of Africa, the continent where the disease was first found. So basically, we can see here that we can quantify the environmental conditions in which the disease occurs and also the environmental conditions in which the disease doesn't occur. So this is the first publication of the disease using ecological niche modeling, then another one, then another one, then another one, and a very recent paper from this month. Here I want to show you, this is a map, the first map in 2006 versus a map from 2016. You can see some very strong similarities between both maps, one with very limited data and another with more data, but the pattern is consistent. And then the more recent paper showing again the same consistent patterns. So under a good design, we really can learn even for a very poorly understood infectious diseases. So when we want to estimate the distribution of species, we can have areas where the species, let's imagine I want to model the distribution of black American black bears. I have areas in which the species is found, we can find it now. Are in dark red here, and there are also areas in which the species is extinct maybe. Here the pink areas, you can see the arrow. So maybe I don't have reports of the species here. So even if I make my map and my ecological niche model is showing that this area is suitable, for some reason I don't have the species there. The species can't be found there. So it could be due to competition with other species. So that occurs a very fine scale. And biotic interactions can reduce the area occupied by species. So here I have a cartoon of Charles Elton, who is one of the fathers of population ecology and community ecology, and was super strong in describing and studying the interaction between species. So his work was focused on a very fine scale, so trying to understand how species interacted negatively or positively. So this is a potential explanation of why we don't find the species there. So that's a problem of a scale. So I leave this paper here because maybe we are focused always reading in the newest paper. This is a not very new paper, but it's a classic in ecology. I suggest to read this paper to have some assumptions clear. But basically, some phenomena that we can see at very fine scale maybe may change at very coarse scale. A group of researchers working in ecological niche modeling theory found that considering the assumptions of Elton could be risky when working with ecological niche modeling, and they proposed the Eltonian noise hypothesis that basically states that at local scale ecological interactions have a lack of effect on a species geographic distribution. So, which, in other words, if you think in the big picture, maybe you don't need to consider the local scale biotic interactions, because you could be able to model the potential distribution of species by neglecting these local scale interactions. So this is the real photo of Charles Elton when he was young. And more of this is described here in this paper of Soberón and Nakamura. This is one of my favorite essays about the concepts of ecological niche modeling. This paper proposes, I guess is this one, I didn't find the term of the Eltonian noise hypothesis in an oldest paper. So last year, this was the 10 years anniversary of the Eltonian noise hypothesis, I guess. So the idea with the Eltonian noise is that maybe I go to the field, I'm studying penguins here in the Antarctic, and I don't find penguins when I go to my, when I develop my field work in this island here where I have the arrow. But maybe 5 years later or during the next season, I find this piece there. So maybe it was not there in my first field work because there was a predator eliminating or reducing the population. So these interactions are very effective to study at the local scale, but when I want to see the big picture, in biotic interactions may cause noise only. These ideas, however, were developed for free living species, that is species for which these interactions may occur at pulses or that are very dynamic. But what about biotic interactions that are more stable and more indispensable? For example, those biotic interactions for non-free living species like parasites. So I have this example here again, the black bear in North America, and a parasite that you can find in black bears, Trichinella. We know that people that hunts and eats black bear meat can acquire this parasite. So maybe I'm interested in trying to identify the areas where Trichinella is. And if I focus in the entire distribution of the host, maybe that's not very informative for what I want to do or understand. So the emerging field of infectious disease distributional ecology, I guess, considers the parasite niche. So we believe, or some believe, that parasites can have a niche. So I have a couple of examples explaining that. Basically, parasites are known that we know that they don't occur randomly. Here, this example is from a virus. A strong pattern that you see here is that the virus can occur in different species of hosts, predators, prey, mammals, reptiles, could be domestic or wild animals. But an important pattern here is that the parasite occurs in the skin tissue, not randomly across the tissues of the different host species. This is another example of a parasite. This is rabies, and it occurs around the globe. And here again, you can see that geographically, the disease or the parasite doesn't occur at random, but I want you to note this list of the species in which the virus occurs in North America. Here you can see that the species occurs in a specific group of animals, in this case mammals, and this may be due to the fact that rabies has a specific requirement of temperature. Mammals have around 37 Celsius degrees of body temperature, but amphibians have a much colder temperature, so the virus doesn't survive. In the case of birds, like poultry, they have very high temperature, around 42 degrees, so that the virus cannot survive. So again, Rabies is not occurring randomly across a host species. This is another example of a parasite. This fungus is causing the Dewino syndrome in bats. And we know that it's found in bats, but not in all bat species. At least in North America, we know that there are 32 species of bats. From these 32 species, only 7 are successfully colonized by this parasite. So this shows again that there could be some special features of the host that make them more suitable to the parasite than others. We have here the final example. This is hantavirus. And for hantavirus, we know that it occurs mainly in rodents and that there are 24 lineages of the virus. The disease can be manifested in the kidney as a renal syndrome that you can see here in purple in the map. Other lineages of the virus are manifested in the lung as a pulmonary syndrome here in green. But in something very important in this figure is that there is a major biogeographic pattern. The lineage causing pulmonary syndrome of hantavirus is restricted to the Americas. And the few reports of the Seoul lineage that you see here in North America has been associated to rats, which are invasive species. So we have very strong signals here that distribution of the lineages of the how the disease is expressed in people has an important geographic pattern. So with the pulmonary syndrome only restricted to the Americas. And if we check the Americas, we see here that the different lineages of hantavirus are associated with specific lineages of rodents. So we explored the distribution or the ecological niches of the different reservoirs of the parasite in South America. And we focus on the detection of the environmental signatures of cases in humans or virus circulation in rodents, and also in rodent species, in all the rodent species associated with the disease. We employed the classic ecological niche modeling workflow related to species occurrences, environmental variables, cleaning of the data, reduction of dimensions and correlation, and developing of the model calibration and model evaluation. There are a series of tools to do that. A tool that I don't have here is KUNM. And then we have the maps of the distribution. So what we did was to explore the ecological niche of the host and the ecological niche of the virus, the parasite. So our question was whether the ecological niche of the parasite and the host were similar. Alternatively, whether the niche of the parasite was indistinguishable of the niche of the host, So basically the question was if these two niches, the parasite and the host, were different. We made a series of models for the different species of hosts and for the virus and the human cases. And this is what we found, that most of the overlap of the reservoir species occur in specific latitudes. And more importantly for this presentation, we found that human cases were occurring at a specific subset of the conditions where reservoirs were occurring in ecological niche dimension. So this was a very interesting discovery. And how I would like to summarize that is that let's imagine that we have a host of a parasite. In this case, for hantavirus, I have a rodent species. Then I map and I understand the distribution of the reservoir species, the host. This host has a parasite that circulates among the population, so there are co-evolutive forces of the parasite and the host. However, we see that the parasite only occurs in a part of the range of the host. The parasite doesn't occur across the entire range of the host, and this has been found in hantavirus and rodents in Chile, where rodents occur at higher elevations where the parasite cannot be detected. Using this ugly but very clever and informative plot, we propose then that the ecological niche of the host here, like light green or olive color, may be big as compared with the ecological niche of the parasite here as a dark green circle. And cases of diseases or transmission of the disease to non-natural hosts like humans, like accidental hosts, is going to occur in a specific subset of ecological space. These discoveries were not particularly new, but they agree with a 1-decade-old report of a potential niche for the parasites, or the parasite niche hypothesis proposed by Maher and collaborators in 2010 for the plague. And what they found is that the distribution of the parasite here in yellow was smaller, or as compared with the distribution of the host. So the parasite was consistently occurring only in a portion of the ecological niche of the hosts. And then that was expressed as the distribution of disease cases only in a small portion of the distribution, a geographic distribution of the host. So how to apply these ideas? Well, first, in A, let's imagine that we have a very simple system, a parasite affecting one host species, so we can model just the vector of this disease. This is a vector-borne disease. We need a virus, we need a vector, and we need the host. We can focus in the vector. Then in B, we may want to include the vector and the host. In C, we may want to focus on different components of the disease system. Like in the avian flu system, we know that there are many species involved. So we may want to develop ecological niche models for each different component to understand where it's more likely to find infections. In the case of dengue, then the ingredients to map dengue, if we have this map that there is very coarse in scale, it goes to a country level, and we want to increase the detail of this map, we will need three main ingredients. First, the vector, then the parasite, and then the host. For human diseases, we neglect a lot the host because we assume that occurs everywhere around the world. So in this case, for mapping the risk of dengue, I am from Guatemala, so let's imagine that I want to model dengue in Guatemala. So this is a map of Guatemala. But I would like you to focus on A in the BAM framework in disease modeling. And first we have the circle that is gray that includes the abiotic variables. In the right, I show here the cloud of points that are all the climates in the world. And then I want you to see M, that is my model calibration area, or my hypothesis of the species dispersal, in black, the black circle, which here is the dispersal in Guatemala. If my study area is Guatemala. So then we have in B, the biotic condition, which could be the distribution of, or a surface of information of where do I find the vector for dengue, for example. So you can see here that if I consider in B only the climates in the world that are restricted to Guatemala, my model is going to find very suitable these areas in red. But if I take into account that mosquitoes could occur in areas beyond Guatemala, and I allow my model to calibrate around the entire area where biotic interactions can occur, so my BAM diagram is going to be different because I'm accounting for the biotic variables that we generally neglect. My model of dengue, if I use cases of dengue to calibrate the model, is going to be very different. So by accounting by the entire distribution of the vector, we can anticipate parts of the distribution of the parasite. This figure shows the distribution of Aedes aegypti, a main vector of dengue in red, and then all the cases of dengue in the world in blue. So you can see that there is a nice agreement here. So definitely this figure shows strong evolutive relationships between the vector and the parasite. Another disease, this is the chytrid fungus. And here you can see that is happening and related to frog, an invasive frog, Xenopus laevis, which is related to the global trade of Xenopus laevis used to as a test for pregnancy. So in the past, there were no the commercial kits of pregnancy, the pregnancy tests that we find in any pharmacy. In the past, they used to take urine of women and they used to inject that urine to frogs, and frogs used to lay eggs if the women were positive in the urine. So after the release of the commercial kits, all these frogs were also released into nature. And we know that this frog is super resistant to the parasite, and maybe that was the way to the global spread of the fungi around the world. We were exploring that hypothesis. I made this analysis of the distribution of Xenopus laevis compared with the distribution of the fungi, and I found that there was no strong agreement between both. So the parasite could be found in areas where the frog was not found. And then researchers collected samples from around the world, and they found the highest diversity of the fungus in Asia. So they proposed that Asia is the original source, especially South Korea, apparently. And that from there was the translocation to other regions in the world. So they then published their findings in a science paper last year. So these cases are when you really understand the natural history of your infectious disease. But let's imagine that you don't understand well the disease. This is an emerging disease. You only have some cases, some outbreaks, isolated epidemics or something. So what you can do if you don't understand what is behind your infectious disease, you can use a black box approach proposed in 2007 in a journal of veterinary medicine by Tom Peterson. And basically, you use the disease cases. You try to find correlation of the distribution of the cases with environmental variables. And then you can see patterns and try to make some inferences from those models. Even if you don't know if the disease is related to a parasite or a specific species of reservoir, you can have some clues about what's going on. So we know that there are emerging infectious diseases happening every year. This is the case of Wuhan coronavirus. This is the global distribution so far. And This could be, these ideas could be used for other infectious diseases. This is a nice example of using niche modeling to explore potential patterns of an infectious disease in nature. This is an example of the Tana pox virus found in Africa. And we believe that this is a vector-borne disease, mainly because people that is positive to the infection tend to report previous bites by insects. However, we are not sure, and we are not sure which insects or what's the natural reservoir. So in this study, researchers collected information about the cases, and they made these ecological niche models of the cases to predict the potential distribution of the parasite. And then they compared the distribution of the parasite with the ecological niche models of different species of potential reservoirs, potential hosts in the nature. So in the end, they made this list of the more likely species that could be the hosts of this parasite in the wild. So we can apply these approaches to very complicated and very poorly understood infectious diseases. So this is a field that is still growing, in which you can collect the data, you can clean the data, and then you can use black box approaches in ecological niche modeling to try to understand the distribution of diseases. This could be very useful now that we know that emergent diseases are expected to be more frequent due to global movement of products on people, land cover, global land cover change, and climate change. There are massive sources of data that we can use to develop this analysis. However, we must be very aware of the risks of bias in the source of data related to infectious diseases. There are some diseases that are more charismatic than others. This is the case of Ebola. This is the amount of tweets for Ebola. And then we see a case in the US in 2014. And you are going to see an explosion of tweets around the world after the disease was found in a traveler in the US. So all this bias in the reports of cases can also bias our ecological niche models. And we should be very aware of the potential biases data for infectious diseases that we still don't understand very well as compared with the biases behind the data for biodiversity. So, for example, for the cases of the 2019 novel coronavirus in Wuhan, in China, I found a few days ago that this was the distribution in the country. And based on that, they made inferences about the maps of transmission risk. And this map basically is showing the distribution of people. We see here higher risk in the area as where we have higher population density at the city level. So more efforts are necessary to have a more mature field of disease risk mapping. And just to finish then, I would like to reinforce the idea that we need to understand well the theory and the assumptions of ecological niche modeling, because we are working in ecological dimensions. And once we learn what is going on in the environmental space, is that we try to understand what's going on in the geographic space. So I suggest this manuscript by Dan Warren, which he explains why we should refer to this analysis or this field as ecological niche modeling instead of species distribution modeling. This is particularly important, I believe, for infectious diseases, in which I have seen a lot of studies in which they throw a list of environmental variables and they don't know why and they just make the maps of colors with red showing very high risk, but they don't know risk of what or what is behind or what are the what is the ecology play of the parasite and the host, for example. So I guess that we need more theory, at least in the applications for public health. This is a study we made with Hu Chia Chiao from the Chinese Academy of Sciences to try to explore the state of the art in ecological niche modeling applications for infectious diseases. We made this analysis using the hypervolume package that tries to reconstruct ecological niches based on kernel density estimations in environmental space. So you can see the output of that model in the left. But we also use Marble that tries to reconstruct ecological niches based on cluster analysis. So both have very similar approaches, but different algorithms. So we were trying to show this. And in the end, we didn't publish these ideas because the editor wanted to see maps. And this was not related to maps. We were very concerned of what was going on in environmental space beyond what was going on in maps. And I don't want to confuse you. Maps are super important to understand or make the interpretation of the models, but we should not be restricted to the use of maps only when we are developing this analysis. And I say that because it's something I have seen too much in applications to infectious diseases. I rarely see the environmental space of analysis to map infectious diseases. So I call that the niche modeling paradox, in which what happens is that we are not super interested in trying to understand the ecology or an evolution of infectious diseases from an environmental dimension. We're more focused on having a very detailed map of the distribution, but we don't know the distribution of what. So you're going to see a series of niche modeling tools, applications for infectious diseases, but be cautious. Because even if it's a very important journal, maybe the conceptual bases are not strong. Summary, we have a good understanding. If you have a good understanding of the natural history of an infectious disease, then you are going to have a good estimation of the potential risk of disease transmission. And you are going to understand what the ecology is saying about the distribution of the specific parasite. Public health applications of niche modeling are behind the status of applications to biodiversity. Most of the theory and the methods have been developed for free living species. So I guess that are very useful to inform managers, but we still have a long road to go. There are many opportunities to understand how two species evolve, the host and the parasite, and using ecological niche modeling is a big opportunity, but the classic concepts maybe need to be adapted to these systems. Thank you.